The following video recording was made possible by the generous donation of Dutrin Productions, Inc., providing video services for the science and technology industry for over 25 years.
We're very lucky today to have two writers that I greatly admire. The first is Amy Harmon, who is a national correspondent for the New York Times, where she writes about the impact of science and technology on American life. She won a Pulitzer Prize in explanatory reporting for her 2008 series, The DNA Age, and was also part of the team that won a Pulitzer Prize for national reporting for the series, How Races Lived in America, in 2001. Amy began her journalism career at the Michigan Daily. Did I get that right?
Yeah.
Yes? All right. The student newspaper at the University of Michigan. After college, she joined the LA Times, and by the mid-90s, by virtue of the fact that she knew how to use email, she was writing about the internet as a social and business phenomena. She joined the New York Times in 1997 and began writing long-form narratives in 2000, when she spent a year following two internet entrepreneurs for a piece exploring how race affected their business and friendship. Her work has been included several times in the Best American Science Writing anthologies, including in 2010's Best of the Best American Science Writing. She is currently writing about the challenges faced by a generation of young adults with autism seeking a foothold in the world. And she and I recently engaged in a three-part Q&A about her work, science writing, and writing more general. And I will actually post links to both Amy's and Kurt's work on the MIT Science Writing blog, both on our site and on the Public Library of Science blog. Our second guest is Kurt Andersen, who is a novelist, journalist, radio host, screenwriter, playwright, and editor. And I stopped at that point because I figured that was enough titles. He began his career at Time in 1981 and served as the magazine's architecture and design critic from 1985 through 1992. He is also the founder of two seminal publications. In 1985, he and Graydon Carter started the much-celebrated satirical magazine Spy, and in 1999, he co-founded Inside, an online and print publication covering the media and entertainment industries, and that was where I first met Kurt. He's been a staff writer at The New Yorker, was the editor-in-chief at New York in the mid-90s, and a columnist for the magazine in the mid-aughts, and is currently a contributing editor at Vanity Fair. He's also the author of two already released remarkable novels, 1999's Turn of the Century and 2007's Heyday. And his next novel, True Believers, will be published this July. His most recent book, Reset, he described it as a, quote, long essay but a short book, which urged people to focus more on the things that make us authentically happy by rediscovering American traditions of realism, pragmatism, and common sense. For the last 12 years, he's been the host of PRI's and WNYC's Studio 360, a weekly one-hour program about science, culture, and the arts. And the three of us will be talking about science writing, past, present, and future. And we'll also be taking questions. Because we only have one mic, we need to take written questions. So there are piles of paper and pencils in the center of everyone's table. So if you have questions, write them and hand them up, and we will field them on the fly. We'll talk for a while, and then we'll take questions. So Kurt and Amy, come on up. You guys have mics? Yes.
We are mics.
Okay, all right. It was just the person with the computer that doesn't have one. So, Amy, I wanted to start by asking you a little bit about the reaction to your recent series. You have published two pieces so far, is that right? In this ongoing series about adults and autism. And they have incorporated some new techniques on the part of the Times for bringing readers into these type of long form narratives. So can you talk a little bit about that and give us a sense of actually how long they are?
Right. So the first of those two pieces was the longest story I had ever written. And I mean, for a magazine piece, it was sort of normal, but for a newspaper, so it was 7,500 words. And when we gave it to Jill Abramson, the executive editor of the Times, right before she sort of officially took over for the, you know, from Bill Keller, she was the first woman editor of the Times, and this was this really momentous event. And we, you know, I had been working on it for 18 months. We sort of slipped it into her at the beginning of August, right before I was about to take a vacation, and I was prepared to be told that I had to just like cut it to 1,100 words, like, you know, which is sort of the average length of a New York Times story, and it was I hoped that wouldn't happen, but she it was my vacation actually depended on it. My August vacation was like, you know, it was either I was going to spend my August vacation cutting the story or I was going to actually get to go on vacation, and she just decided that she would run it at length, and I think that part of the reason she did that, actually, we talked about the future of science journalism here, and is because it did incorporate this new element, which is it really tried to sort of seamlessly as we could, and in a different way than we ever had before, use video and audio and sort of, you know, as part of the story. So we don't have the ability to show it to you here, but if you did look at it, you know, you read it, and there are sort of these links where you can. Part of my frustration with writing this story was that I was trying to write about this young man who is autistic, and to describe him, as much as I sort of slaved over the description and you know, used my best talents as a wordsmith to try to explain what he was like, it wasn't really coming through. And so the best way to do that was through video. So what is Justin? How does he talk? What is he like? And so we used these links that sort of pop up videos that don't like take you out of the story, but actually just pop up a little 30-second video within the print story so that you can see. And so I think that Jill Abramson, the executive editor, liked that element of it, and she liked the story enough to print it at 7,500 words. And I got to go on vacation, which was really nice.
and was it one thing that really intrigued me about the use of those videos was oftentimes I associate videos with a newspaper or a magazine story as being some part of the interview that I've already read, just shown on tape. And what was really, I thought, very striking about that video was that those segments they had unique content to the video. It wasn't interview clips that had been featured anywhere else. Was that something? It was obviously a conscious choice, but was that something that was talked about or discussed? Or
so in the first of the two stories, it was an afterthought. I mean, it really arose out of this sense of like, gee, you know, you spent 18 months on this story and your print version isn't really doing it for us. Like, what can we do to make this person come to life? I mean, and so we had, as the Times often does now, we had done a video to accompany the story, like a sort of a mini documentary type video, but there was a lot of stuff that we didn't use. And so we kind of took the stuff that was on the cutting room floor and we integrated it, and it came to life in this new way. And then for the second of the stories, we thought, well, okay, now we know that really worked, that helps, like that's good. And so we did it, you know, it's a different kind of journalism to try to conceive of a piece that is an integrated version of, you know, sort of print and video. It really is, it's not two separate ways of telling the story, it's some trying to do it as a whole. And I find it challenging, and I tried to do it better in the second time around, and I hope to do it again in my next. So,
yeah. Right. And Kurt, I want to talk a little bit about some of what you're doing at Studio 360, but first I wanted to touch on this piece you wrote for Vanity Fair, which was, I guess, did it come out last January?
Yes.
About the Large Hadron Collider. And I'm curious about what was the genesis of that assignment? And when you got that, what did you feel like you had to do before you went over there to prepare yourself?
The genesis was, I had a year or two earlier than that sort of agreed to write some number of pieces for Vanity Fair. And however, this came in the fall of 2010, just as I was nearing the end of this novel that's about to come out, or, well, thought I was nearing the end of this novel that was about to come out. And it was...
Your editor had a different...
Well, you know, life had... Right. Anyway, it took longer. But my point being that this was not a good time for me to take on a, I don't know what it was, 6,000, 7,000 word piece. But when my editor at Vanity Fair called up and said, you know the Large Hadron Collider? I said, of course I know about the Large Hadron Collider. So, well, it's just about to be turned on, and they will allow one more journalist to go and take a tour and spend a week at CERN in Geneva, where it is, and talk to all the particle physicists there. And would you like to do this? And it was really as though they had contrived to say, how can we get this guy to spend a month not working on the book that is due soon? Because it was one of those assignments that literally I would have paid to do. But then there's the question of course, I am not, among the many things I am not, is a trained physicist or theoretical physicist. And so my particle physics was a little rusty. And I spent, essentially 2 weeks, 3 weeks before I went cramming on, the history of accelerators and what we used to call atom smashers and Higgs bosons and all the rest, in order to be able to, as all journalists must do, fake it.
Right.
To sort of talk to these scientists and not have them think, you creep.
We're instituting the fake it part of the curriculum next year.
Well, but of course you have to get up to a certain level to be able to fake
right.
it.
Yeah.
And I've had experience. I mean, A, being a journalist, there is a certain amount of fake it-ness
sure.
in being a journalist. And you mentioned that I'd been the architecture critic for Time Magazine. Well, talk about faking it. I mean, I'd taken, a couple of courses in college in architectural history.
Down the
road over here. But I will get back to the Large Hadron Collider in a moment, but once somebody says, do this, then you do your best to do it well, and you do it a few more times, and suddenly that world thinks, oh yeah, he's legit.
Right.
So, which is really the story of being a journalist, I think. But anyway, so I went to CERN, and it was a marvelous week I spent there, and I didn't know, other than they're about to turn it on, oh, what is this going to be? I had to figure out a way. Of course, I had to be able to understand, the nature of what it was doing, but also had to make it an interesting story for Vanity Fair magazine. I don't think most people who buy Vanity Fair buy it in order to read about theoretical physics. I could be wrong, but I don't think that's true. But that said, I just found it a miraculous, marvelous, almost, I talked about it as being a kind of, $8 billion installation art piece, which I think it sort of is one way to understand it. I talked about it as this sort of, irreligious, religious cathedral. But I also talked about the actual physics that were being done and were being proposed to be done. And also the very peculiar, wonderful nature of CERN, this place where hundreds of physicists from all over the world work and live together, working on projects like this one for decades. Right. And on various levels, once I got there and saw what it was and experienced what it was, I saw that it was, you know, it was tempting, frankly, to write a book about the place. But what came out of it was a piece in Vanity Fair. And also, I think key for this piece, the instigator of this piece was the photographer who took these extraordinary pictures of this largest machine ever built on
Imagine
Earth.
PowerPoint slides.
Yes. Yeah. If there were technology right. at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, we would have that. But anyway, it began as this photographer saying, oh, I can get into the Large Hadron Collider and take these amazing pictures, and they'll never be able to be taken again because it'll be running. And again, that's what made it, I think, to a large degree, possible to have this large, fairly dense piece of journalism was that they knew that they were going to get these great photos as well.
And so when you were, after you'd been there and done the research and you were writing the piece, to what extent were you conscious of the fact that this was, on some level, going to be a hard sell? I mean, it is a fairly dense piece for a publication that does not typically run dense pieces about physics. Or did you have enough faith in the story at that point where it just seemed obvious that it was going to run at whatever length it was going to run?
That's a good question. I mean, one is always nervous, you know, when you turn in anything. Article or a book or whatever. I never thought that. I mean, they knew they were getting a long piece
right.
about the Large Hadron Collider.
Right.
So, I guess I wasn't nervous about that. But I guess I thought that the sort of exciting challenge of it was A, making me understand it. Being able to understand the science to the degree that I could then explain it to people who perhaps understood it a little less well on average than I did, and make it entertaining and interesting. So it was just enough. It was just terrifying enough that it was interesting, which is
right.
again,
a lot of
my journalism rule right. number two, in addition to learning to fake it.
Right. Amy, one interesting thing that you said in a conversation that we were having was that you have not thought of yourself as a science journalist, despite the fact that you've now been covering science for over a decade, and won 1.5 Pulitzers writing about science. I thought the distinction you made was really interesting because at least in your own mind, it seemed like, and correct me if I'm wrong, that a science writer or a science reporter was someone who was interpreting journal articles or taking research, taking sort of cutting edge research, and interpreting that for the public. And that was something that you felt like you weren't, that wasn't your strength.
Yes.
And we then took, I think, 2 or 3 lines of one of your story and kind of dissected the amount of knowledge and research that went into your being able to say those lines authoritatively. And they were lines that you know weren't attributed to anyone. They were can you talk a little bit about, you're someone who was not trained in science, about what goes into that part of your work. You're writing these human narratives. But there's a lot of knowledge that's underneath there, and can you talk about the preparation, what's required for that?
Right. So yeah, it was you, Seth, who convinced me that I really was a science reporter after all these years. But yes, I did sort of feel like I passed myself, like it was almost fraudulent to say that I was a science writer because I don't have a background in science, and I depend so much on, you know, all of these interviews with experts and just, you know, asking people to read my work and make sure that I haven't made an error. And but, you know, I mean, your point, which I think was true, is that, you know, that makes you a science writer when you're trying to distill 28 hours of interviews with scientists
into two sentences,
which is what I did in, you know, one of these autism stories, because I really So for certainly for the first autism story, really part of what made it possible was work like that Seth in particular had done, and a few others, you know, in writing about, you know, what causes autism. Because, you know, if you're writing about autism, the first thing anybody wants to know is, well, you know, why, you know, are we having an autism epidemic? What's happening? Why is there so much about autism in the news lately? And, you know, Seth had written this amazing book, which everybody should read if they haven't, called The Panic Virus. And you know, about the fact that vaccines don't cause autism. So, but for my reporting, I had to kind of wade through a lot of the research about that and to make sure that I really understood, you know, what the cause, you know, I had to explain the spike in autism diagnoses over the last 20 years, which really is, you know, largely attributable to the fact that autism is better recognized and that the definition of autism is broadened a little bit. And so, you know, yeah, so I mean, I did do tons and tons of interviews and read Seth and read others and, you know, tried to really wrap my head around that aspect just to be able to write about, to sort of have as my starting off point the fact that, you know, we have a larger generation of people with autism now, and the reason that we have that is because of the definition and because of the recognition and not because of some strain, you know, something in the, you know, in the environment that hasn't been explained or that is attributable to vaccines. What I really wanted to write about was, you know, okay, now that we have these young adults who have kind of come through the system and been educated in a different way and have benefited from better therapies and have benefited from better, you know, more awareness at an earlier age, you know, what is going to happen to these young adults as they age out of the educational system where they have a lot of, you know, built-in supports and services? Are they going to join society? Are we going to sort of, you know, expand our understanding to include people who act weirdly and differently and whose brains are wired differently? Or are they going to, you know, be sort of forced back into their homes and into institutions as they have been in the past? The point is that a lot of that was, I wrote, you know, maybe thousands of words about the science of what we know about autism and what we know about the diagnosis and what we know about what causes it. And I really did try to end up, I did distilled it into maybe three sentences with hyperlinks. The hyperlinks were very useful because if anybody wanted to really, you know, reference the original sources, I could link to them. And for people who really cared about that, I wanted to show, you know, yes, I've done the research and it's here. If you want to look at, you know, why the spike, you know, what causes it, and you can click on these links, and I'll link you to these journal articles. But I didn't want to bog down my narrative about this young man who was trying to find a job in his last years of high school with that kind of material.
One thing that's interesting about that is that I think that you're describing a situation that, with the loss of dedicated science sections, science reporters are increasingly facing, which is, it sounds like on some level, those thousands of words that you wrote that ended up getting distilled into those couple of sentences was for your editor as much as anything else. And it was, you were having a whole discourse with your editor who was not a dedicated science editor. Is that something that you're conscious of? Is that a tension needing to explain oftentimes some fairly complicated situations and just to explain why we're not going to write about this or we don't need to include a section about X or Y?
I think it is, yeah. I think that, you know, you have to become expert enough on a subject to be able to explain it to an editor and to have the authority, and also just for myself, I mean, it's for my editor and for myself, to sort of have the authority to be able to say, I know why I can, you know, not spend those thousand words on this and why I can sort of take off from where I am and write the narrative that, I mean, you know, I believe in science as narrative. I mean, I really, and actually it was, you know, I was listening to a Studio 360, which I subscribe to as a podcast, so I usually listen to it as a podcast while I'm riding my bike, and it was something that Kurt said, was something about you were interviewing George Saunders, the writer who wrote a fiction story for The New Yorker recently about war, basically, and it says, it was like the classic Kurt, like, you know, amazing insight that he's like just slips in into his interviews, you know. So about, like, you know, he said, you know, you imagine other minds as your profession, or so something. Probably he said it better than that, but you know, and I thought, like, that's what I aspire to do, is to imagine myself into someone else's mind. Like, what I really want to do in a science story is to transport the reader into the mind of somebody else who's real, though, who's not fiction, you know, and make you understand that. And so, and that, like, there's so much that goes into it. That's hard, right? I mean, you guys do it too. And so that's hard enough without kind of getting bogged down into the, like, the nitty-gritty of the science. And so I try to slip the science in a way that is just, you know, that you don't get stuck on it. Right. So that's my aspiration. And so to do that, you know, but as you pointed out, to do that, you still need to do all the interviews and to really understand the science well enough to just be able to slip it in.
Right. And that's a nice segue to Studio 360. And it's now, you've been doing the show for 12 years.
Correct.
And over the last 5 or 6 years, there seems to have been, I don't know if it's a focus, but a sub-focus on science and creativity, the intersection of science and art. And I was curious as to, one, how and why that came about, and two, what the reaction to some of those segments has been. A lot of them are very striking to me, but that could be because that's where my interests are anyway.
I mean, Studio 360 began as, is still mainly a culture, arts and culture and entertainment show, and that's what it's about. And actually, it's a little less than 12 years, 11 years, but yes, close enough, now that I think about it. We began doing science-y things partly because about the time we were starting the show was about the time I began, having always been interested in science, became even more interested in science. And, for instance, said to my producers, let's get Alan Lightman, this novelist who wrote this extraordinary novel that I just read in Galleys, on the show. And yes, we'll talk some about science and also about the novel and fiction. And that happened again and again, where my interest in science, I found ways to you know, make it meet the you know, arts and culture bailiwick of the program. Then we were doing it so regularly that either somebody had the idea, and I honestly don't know who had the idea, to get the Alfred Sloan Foundation to fund even more stories about, and conversations and radio pieces about the interstices of arts and science.
I need to figure out a way to get funded by accident, or not get funding without knowing how it happened.
Well, you know, that as I've become in the last decade through doing this radio show, talent, I don't have to know that anymore.
Right.
Other people do it for me. But anyway, we did get funded, and the Sloan Foundation's been great. And really, it's allowed us, instead of doing this occasional thing, not wanting to turn this arts and culture show into a science show, to do it regularly. And so we've done it, we do a piece every second week, and then 2 or 3 hours a year that are entirely about some theme. We did one recently about bionic stuff.
Transhumanism,
right. All that. And we did a whole show that may have been actually before the Sloan Grant. I lose track because it's something we were doing and would do anyway. But we did a whole show on Nikola Tesla and the sort of revival and enthusiasm for Tesla today among musicians and writers and artists of various kinds. We've commissioned short stories by people like Lydia Millett and others to, you know, that are all around scientific subjects. So we do all kinds of things. And then the question is, the other part of your question was how people react. It's funny. I mean, p- people seem to like this part of what we do a lot, because again, it's in the people come to Studio 360. Well, maybe just because NPR is on and they keep listening, but they come to Studio 360 to learn about authors and filmmakers and musicians and ideas of that kind. And so I think, so, you know, it's not necessarily the math and science kids who are listening to Studio 360. So then this science stuff comes up in a way, because what CP Snow called, of course, the two cultures, it's adjacent to their interest because it's part of this show. It's about, say, a you know, folk singer who became a biochemist, which is a piece we did recently, right. Or about this or this biochemist who was studying biochemistry at the University of Chicago in 1975 when Gravity's Rainbow came out, and Gravity's Rainbow became his touchstone for his work in biochemistry. So it's never purely about science, but it's always about science as well as how these disciplines interact. People respond really positively. I mean, the Tesla show, I mean, has these extraordinary metrics of most podcasts ever, or, you know, for our show anyway. So they really are very positively responded to, and I think, but even more, I'm happy that people don't see them, listeners don't regard them as some strange other thing we're doing, but that it's this, you know, suburb of what we're already doing naturally. Of course there are, adjacencies, natural connections between, for instance, the experimental method, strictly speaking, in science, and the experimental method of every artist I know. You know, so the fact that it's not regarded as this strange other thing, but as kind of natural, coexisting extension is what pleases me more than people don't say I wish you'd do more science. They accept it as this.
It's part of an organic.
Exactly.
Whole, right.
I mean, I think that's true. I'll just, because I forgot to answer your question about the reaction to the autism stories or to some of the other stories. It's true of me, because you always wonder, like, who's the audience? Like, who's going to read this? Is it just going to be? And, you know, so some portion of the response to my autism stories was from more, you know, it was gratifying to hear from people who have a personal connection to autism, that, you know, they felt that it accurately represented their experience. But I mean, I think more so was, comments like on the New York Times, you know, the Times has, you can comment on stories on the website. And also people who emailed me who just said, you know, I don't know what autism is. You know, I never had a really connection to autism, but like now I feel like I know what autism is, or, you know, the sense of, I mean, you know, I think that there is such a broad audience for science writing that that goes beyond even like the Science Times or a science section. I think that this, I was talking to Tom Levinson earlier at my table, who, you know, talks about, you know, the idea of like not sort of ghettoizing science, but having it integrated into things like, you know, culture and studio.
Well, and as it is, I mean, you know, Malcolm Gladwell has made a career out of being a science writer,
right,
essentially. You know, Daniel Kahneman has a bestseller of a book that is, half about the science of psychology and half about economics. And, I think we're living in maybe the beginning of or early in a golden age of science writing, some of which doesn't call itself science writing.
Right. There's Charles Duhigg's new book,
Habit.
Habit.
Yeah.
Jonah Lehrer's work. One thing I want to ask both of you about, I was very struck, and I don't actually remember if it was a conversation we were having or if it was an online conversation you were having that I read somewhere else, but you said you were constantly living in fear of whatever article you did being the last article that you were able to do of that length or that size, and were worried that, you know, your editors at the Times were going to come in and say, all right, Amy, you know, that's it. It's on to obituaries for you, which I think is unlikely. But it actually, for all the talk over the last several years about the decline in long-form journalism, it feels to me like, and there's some evidence to support this, that we've been seeing a resurgence and a renewed interest in long-form journalism. And there are, in fact, these new avenues and outlets for it, like Byliner and The Atavist. And I was actually, when I read your piece, I was thinking, well, that if that does not find a home in the Times in the future, there are actually now places that are doing quite well that I think that could find a home at. And I wonder if either of you have thoughts about whether we're seeing a shift in where long-form journalism is going to be appearing in the future, how it's consumed, how it's supported.
The thing is that, and I do, right, so I say this often and I still do feel it. I do worry that, you know, that because long-form journalism is expensive. It's just, it just is. It takes, to do it well takes time. And so if you're going to be paid for your time, you're paid a salary, you know, so the Times is paying me. And so my colleagues at the newspaper are writing, you know, 100 stories a year, and I'm writing 3 or 5, you know, a few stories a year. So it, you know, they look at that and they're like, well, is this, you know, is it worth it? And, you know, hopefully they think it's worth it. And so far they have thought it was worth it. And I guess I am sort of encouraged. I mean, I've been encouraged even just by recent conversations with the top editors at the New York Times. So they, you know, that they feel like, you know, I considered maybe switching to trying to write for the Times Magazine. And they told me, well, no, we think these stories for the paper are important. That, like, these stories, you know, have kind of a different mix. You know, we want this kind of thing in the New York Times. So that's good, right? That's some sort of job security. And so, you know, but I agree with you. I mean, The Atavist, especially, because and Kindle Singles, and, you know, other types of platforms that use multimedia, that, I mean, in a similar way to the way that my autism stories did, they sort of lace in this video and other kinds of other forms of reporting, and I think that people are reading them and they're buying them, which is very encouraging to anybody who cares about this, you know, trying to make a living doing this kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I am of the things one can be despairing about in, you know, the culture and journalism and the rest. I am not despairing about long form journalism. I mean, When there were more newspapers and newspapers were healthier, there was a lot of bad long form journalism, by the way, and you know, I guess if I had to guess, I'm not sure there. I still feel as though I read a great long piece of journalism as often as I did in the supposed golden ages of 20 and 30 years ago. So. Whether it's, you know, people like Amy that you know, singular institutions like the New York Times gives the space to do that, or the New Yorker or New York Magazine or another half dozen magazines you can name, and Atavist and Byliner, I guess I feel as though between a kind of commitment to excellence beyond that which is perhaps strictly economically rational, and then these new modes that I think will, you know, prove successful, that are proving successful, as Amy said, like Kindle Singles and other ways. I don't see, it's a weird transitional time, but I guess I am genuinely more hopeful about there continuing to be enough places for the best long-form journalism going forward.
I want to shift gears as dramatically as we can from long-form journalism and ask one final question about Twitter. And after that, open it up to any questions. We'll just take a couple of minutes because I want to let everyone have dessert. And I know this is late as my wife and I have been out in several years, so I'm sure there are some of you who are ready to go home. But I know both of you are fairly active on Twitter. And I was speaking recently with Emily Bell, who teaches at Columbia and was instrumental in setting up The Guardian's website, a great journalist. And she is very adamant in her belief that Twitter, with the exception of the printing press, and she said, and possibly not even that, is the single best tool ever invented for journalists. And I was curious about whether you two found Twitter to be something that was a help in your work, was a distraction in your work, if it was something that you felt like helped you find readers or find sources, or what purpose it serves in your work lives.
It's both a help and a distraction. I should say, like it can definitely. I think Twitter. I think Twitter is great. Like on the, you know, in net, I think it's definitely a positive. I mean, I think that I am able to kind of digest and also be in touch with just like people that I would never have known. But I mean, I think, you know, you and I have talked on Twitter. Right. You know, I mean, I don't know. You know, so there's like this community that I would never have been able to reach or be a part of otherwise. And I've also used it for crowdsourcing, as the phrase goes. But you know, for people who I've had people tell me stories that I'm, you know, I'm about actually to use in a story that I would never have had, you know, the opportunity to hear before. And so it's also incredibly distracting and sort of, you know, there's a sense of like, oh my God, everybody else is reading this and I have to read this and like I have to read these 25 stories that I wouldn't even have known before existed, you know, at between 9 and 12, like instead of doing my own work between 9. So, I mean, there is a distracting factor, but I think it's, you know, on the whole, it's definitely a positive, a great tool for me to be kind of hooked into other communities and just kind of eavesdrop on conversations that I wouldn't otherwise have been able to hear. So it's good. Yeah.
I can't say I find it useful in my work. In the helping me, I don't send out tweets saying, "Can somebody? Does anybody know anybody in Oklahoma City who knows about X, Y, Z?" I've never done that.
Right.
I know journalists do. However, as a reader. And of course, being a reader feeds whatever one writes in any, as a journalist, as a fiction writer, anything. I find it in the digital glut of stuff that has been created in the last 15 years, I find it an incredibly useful, essentially gatekeeper guide to pieces and things that I wouldn't know about, and I'm glad. I mean, I would say every day, what Amy regards as a distraction of things she feels she has to read, I find every day, I would say, something I find or see or read that I wouldn't have absent the my several hundred guides in my Twitter feed. The other thing, I mean, that has been true of the internet from the beginning, but I find even truer of Twitter is when you write a piece and people tweet about it. I have a greater sense of
watching that spike.
Responsiveness and people
feedback,
who
yeah.
argue with it or love it or hate yeah. it or, I think that's great. And so you know in that sense of readership. Another thought I just before this is not about Twitter or social media, but the thing about, I mean just another. Note of hopefulness about the future of serious and thoughtful journalism, science journalism and otherwise. I mean, you know, public radio has 35 million listeners. It's the one world of media that is not fracturing, but rather growing and consolidating. And Radio Lab was invented at my home station, WNYC, 7 years ago. And We Do Science and Science Friday is still going on. And they are creating new shows all the time. So again, not to be Panglossian or Pollyannish, but I see opportunity.
And Radiolab has been, both for WNYC and for public radio, has been a big success.
It's a huge success, and in every sense, and has...
And has created a new... I mean, before Radiolab, there was no 10 times a year really deep dive program.
Right. Now, they've created a new model that is really... I mean, the instead of, as with most thing, most radio programs, most everything, certainly most public radio programs, oh, you do your show over terrestrial radio, as they call it, and you put it out on podcasts as well. This, because it started more recently, it started, you know, in this century, it really began with a whole different model of essentially a weekly podcast, but then these 10 incredibly worked over labor-intensive shows a year that are broadcast, and it's essentially a podcast show, you know, that also happens to be on the radio sometimes.
Right. Right.
So as we are looking at new models, I mean, you can't call anything a public radio a business model, but models of distribution to emerge. This to me, again, this is a way of attracting an audience and getting really extraordinarily good, thoughtful journalism out in a way that, in both conceptually and, you know, and in every other way, wasn't possible a decade ago.
Right. Are there questions that people have and have written down, or is everyone too lubricated to? Rob, are you can pass it out, or is that? Yeah, Alan.
Well, we've seen a lot of evolution of media in the last 15 years, and Twitter is the latest. What kind of, how do you think science is going to be conveyed 10 years from now? Do you think it'll be a super Twitter, or what will it be?
Could people hear that?
Repeat it.
You're going to have to repeat it again, because I was reading Rob's question.
What will journalism be 10 years from now?
So,
the evolution of the media.
One thing I hope, there's actually a... an article that was circulated on Twitter that I saw recently, which was kind of the lament of a scientist about how scientists are essentially taught to write in this horrible, dry manner that nobody can understand. And I think the headline or the tweet was something like, "Must this dryness be written by us?" And it was purposely phrased in the passive tense, because that's how they're taught to write in the passive tense, which, you know, you try not to write in the passive tense if you're trying to write for people to read. And one thing that I have started reading more lately is I follow scientists on Twitter, actual scientists, you know, like practicing scientists, and I read some of their blogs. I mean, I hope that you ask how science will be communicated. I hope that scientists, and I hope that, you know, MIT will help to train scientists to write in a way so that, you know, lay people can actually understand what they're talking about, and so that we can have more of an actual dialogue with scientists. I think that that's beginning. I think that Twitter is a beginning of that. You know, blogs are a beginning of that. There are many scientists that have their own blogs now. And even if it sort of takes one more step for journalists to interpret them, it helps for scientists to be out there themselves kind of talking about their work and actually trying to communicate with journalists and the public.
And of course, I mean, Twitter, it has a name that I don't think ever will seem anything other than slightly silly and demeaning, but and they're therefore successful. But I think we have to understand that it can do several things, but it seems to me it can essentially be a headline and then link you to a learned journal article or whatever thing. And to me, that's one of its great utilities. Or it can be, wisecracks and aphorisms, and those probably aren't the way that science is communicated. right. As delightful as they may be. But truly, in the important part of Twitter, and the part that is actually vital to me rather than just amusing to me, is sending me to extraordinary Hubble telescope images, or if I didn't know Seth, his work on autism or Amy's. So it's a distribution, it's a headline distribution medium that then you can use to dive into, and in that way it can be as useful for science journalism as for any other journalism, it seems to me.
I think this is both a comment and a question, and we'll probably, with the dessert being handed out, we'll probably end with this. I would love any thoughts about this from either of you. So the integration of the arts and culture with science in Studio 360 versus the loss of dedicated science sections in a lot of places, not yet the Times, thankfully, raises the issue of whether in the end we want science alone for itself or science thoroughly integrated into the rest of life. And is this, Rob, is this, so, and when do you mean raises the question of whether we want science alone for itself, whether we as information consumers or we as a culture or?
I think what I was trying to say was that I've heard with a sort of a sense of grief the loss of dedicated science section.
Right.
That's a bad thing, that's a sad thing, you don't want to see the Times do that. And then on the other hand, we hear extolled virtues of science integrated into the rest of life with culture and the art. Which do we want? I have my own preference.
Right.
I'm curious to hear.
Well, what Rob just said was that we simultaneously talk very mournfully about the loss of dedicated science sections, and at the same time extol ways in which we're able to integrate science coverage into arts or culture, or just integrate it into the front section of the Times instead of in Science Times. And I think what I mean when I talk about that in a way that is mournful is that it's out of an anxiety that when you lose dedicated science sections, those science reporters don't then write about science in other sections, they're just gone. And what I think is troublesome is when you have a general assignment reporter who has no scientific background or training, who's told one day, okay, you need to write about this press release from a hospital or controversy, or so something like Studio 360, or when Kurt can spend a month working on a story about the Large Hadron Collider, or when Amy can spend months and months working on stories, even though you're not attached to the Science Times section. I personally love. I find it scary when places not like the New York Times get rid of science reporters and don't seem to have any plan or conception or desire to replace them or retain that knowledge base. So.
It seems to me that's the, I agree with that, and I also think, I guess, that worrying about whether there are, yes, not having expert people on an important beat is a problem. A section, I think in this day and age, especially in the sort of inherently centrifugally disaggregating function, dynamic of what digital is doing to newspapers and magazines. I mean, sections, I think, are the least of our worries. I was just talking to a staff of a weekly newspaper recently, and they were all saying, why does anyone care about anything but an individual article that attracts their attention? Right. What does a newspaper bring to anything? So it's not just a science section, it's,
A newspaper, right.
I would say, is the bigger question about sections in an age when everybody can get each individual, journalistic tapas that they want,
I'll go back to the idea of science as story. And I think that whether, like, I would be very sad to not read, like, Dennis Overby, who's in the Science Times, you know, telling the story of the latest advance in physics, because he tells that story so beautifully. Whether we need a separate science section to, you know, reinterpret every journal article that's out there, I don't, you know, maybe not. I mean, I think that people, I think that science journalism is more important now than maybe ever. I mean, we have a society, you know, we're facing such challenges in science that I don't need to tell anybody in this room. I mean, you know, does climate change exist? I mean, there are people, you know, there are like really powerful people in our society that don't believe that climate change exists.
Really powerful people running for president.
Yes, not to get into, yes. So so I feel like being able to command the attention of the average reader is, you know, in terms of communicating truth about science is so important. And I think the way to do that, I think is almost like in this stealth way, through like telling them stories that people want to hear and are sort of wired to hear. And I think people, you know, in whether it's in like separate science sections or whether it's on the front page of the Times or whether it's in Studio 360 or sort of, you know, the, all these hybrid ways, however it works, is important. And I don't have like a, you know, a feeling of whether we need to have the separate sections or whether we need to have it integrated. Just whatever vehicle is the best for the story. Whether it could be a tweet, you know.
Well, thank you all for sitting so patiently through our discussion and for coming to the celebration. It has been a wonderful weekend. I think we have some dessert, and hopefully we will all see all of you soon.
Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this program as much as we did. Please visit us online at dutrumproductions.com to see how video can help grow your business.